Greetings, our Hebrew Israelite brothers and sisters. This is L.D. Smith, the watchman on the wall. Israel, it is our Sabbath. Would you kindly grab that King James? First of all, before we get started tonight in our teaching, we here at LoudOfMeNoMore.org, we want to wish all of our sisters and brothers all over happy Sabbath. Now, that being said, moving forward in our teaching tonight, we're going to expose Lucifer, a.k.a. Jesus, again. And tonight's teaching is very interesting. As I always say, I want you to listen to the wording and think about what we're saying while you're reading it, okay? And for you Christians, you guys in trouble. I'm going to expose your so-called God and show you how big a liar he is, all right? Now, let's go to the book of Matthew, the 25th chapter, all right? And we're going to begin at verse 14. Are we there? Okay. It says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling in a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. Unto one he gave 5 talents, and to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several abilities, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received 5 talents went and traded with we just gonna cut through the chase here. Two of them went out and they traded and they made something out of their talents, okay? But one he hid his, all right? Now let's get on down here to verse. Let's read verse 19. It says, "After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoned with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and bought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Okay, he made a profit. Okay, all right. So we're gonna we're gonna jump on down and get into the good part. But let me just kind of just give you an overview on it. As I said before, two of them went out and they made a profit, and then one of them didn't make a profit. All right. Now, let us go on down here. Let us jump to verse. Let's go to verse 26. Okay. Look what it says. He said, "And his Lord answered." Let's look at 25. He said, "And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine." He says here, "His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knowest that I reap where I soweth not, and goeth where I have not sown." Okay, but anyway, to make a long story short here, he is telling him that he is slow and he's worthless and this and that. The whole story has nothing to do with his plan of salvation. If you see what I'm saying, it has nothing to do with his plan of salvation. He said that he came to save his people. And that's what it says in Luke, Matthew, also Mark. He said he came to save his people. But let us look here a little further here. Look what he says in 29. He says, "For unto everyone that has shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But for him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he has." So in other words, he's saying, well, since you didn't go out and invest in anything and produce anything, I'm going to take that from you, which I gave to you. Now think about that. That doesn't make any sense at all. I know how we have been taught here in Western civilization and how they have programmed our mind to think, but this here doesn't make any sense at all, and I'm going to show it to you now. Look what it says here. 30 says, "And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of the teeth." Now, my question is that, like I said, this has nothing to do with salvation. But why, if you gave an individual something and they decided, well, I don't want to invest it, why would you cast them into outer darkness or so-called hell? If you see what I'm saying. But anyway, let's go a little further here. We're going to jump down to verse 31 here. Look what it says. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. Now, we're going to come back and deal with that, you know what I mean, because that right there is an insult to me and to the Most High. But we'll go a little further. Let us go ahead. It says, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as the shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. All right, now let's look at 33 and 34. It said, and he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king, talking about Jesus, say unto them on the right hand, come ye, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. All right, now, let us just rest and park on that for a moment. He's saying that he's making a parable of this Lord and his servant to how he is going to be, talking about the king himself, when he comes back. Now, my question is, look at what he wants the Christians to do. Okay, and then now, remember now, they have been saved and they have salvation. But look what he said. He talks about when I was hungry. He talks about when I was thirsty. He talks about when I was a stranger. He talks about when I was naked. He talks about when I was in prison. He talks about all these things that the Christian has to do. See, because Christian, if you don't do this, he got a plan for you. Know what your plan is? Let's read 45 and 46. Look what he says. Then shall he answer them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Now, why would you serve a God that promised you all these promises? He promised you salvation, so whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, and all these other things that he promised you. And yet it's still, if you don't do what he, if you don't go out and feed, if you don't go out and clothe, if you don't go out and give someone a drink, this is the outline that he has for the Christian. Now, my question is, how many Christians have done all of this? See, because your salvation depends on this. Because apparently your salvation ain't worth a damn, because he can give it to you and take it back. If you see what I'm saying. Well, let's look at something else. Let's go to Ephesians. Let me show you what he has there for you, for the Christian. It's nothing but a bunch of rubbish. It makes no sense at all. Let's go to the book of Ephesians, Ephesians 1. Well, let's go to Ephesians 4 first. Ephesians 4, let's look at verse 30. Look what it says here. Ephesians 4 and 30 says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. See that? Now, how can you be sealed, and then if you don't feed somebody, or if you don't clothe somebody, or if you don't go and visit them out there in prison, see what I'm saying? Then you don't have any salvation. He said you can be cast out into out of darkness, everlasting punishment. But that's what I want to say. How can you promise these people? How can your precious Lord and Savior, who you call Jesus Christ, who is Lucifer himself, how can he make all these promises to you and then tell you that if you don't do all these works of community service, all right, then he's going to take your salvation from you. But he tells you that you are sealed. Let's go a little further. Let's back up. Let's go to Ephesians 1. Let's look at verse 13. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, it says, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Now you got a promise of the Holy Spirit. All these things, all these components that he have given you, but yet and still, he say, if you don't go out and feed nobody, you don't go out and give someone a drink, or you don't go and visit someone, or you don't clothe anyone, he is going to cast you, I think. Let me read again. Yes, he says, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous shall inherit eternal life. Now, I thought that he said that your salvation wasn't based on works alone, or works. It was this, I believe. I mean, why does it keeps on changing, my sisters and brothers? I mean, clearly one can see here that this is nothing but a bunch of rubbish. But look at verse 14 here in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, let's look at verse 14. Look what it says here. It says, which is the earnest of our inheritance. In other words, this is a guarantee. Now you've been sealed, you got a promise, now you got a guarantee. Look what he says here now. He says, of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchase. See what I'm saying? Possession. Until the praise of his glory. Already bought it. Purchase. Possession. He's already obtained it. How can he say, well, okay, well, you didn't do this or you didn't do that, then your salvation isn't any good any longer. How can anyone believe in this garbage that's over here in the New Testament? My sisters and brothers, it makes no sense at all. It makes no sense at all. Now, I'm going to show you some. Let's go back to Matthew 25. Let us go. Let's look at verses. Let's look at verses 30. 30, 31, and 32. Let's read that again. Look what it said. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. Now, we all know that the Most High says that he shares his glory with nobody. I have talked about this in I don't know how many videos, where the Most High says that there is no God, there is no other God besides me. He says, who can you say that I'm equal to? I mean, all through Isaiah writing, he keeps on stating, even in the book of Hosea, he says that I'm the only God. There is no other. But here Jesus, I don't know what throne he's talking about. He's going to set up on or what holy angels that is with him. I have no idea what this fellow's talking about. And look what he says here. He says, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from goats. Now, my question to this right here, this is what Jesus is talking about. He's going to do. And he's going to go to all the nations, and he's going to separate. That couldn't be further from the truth, my sisters and brothers. That couldn't be further from the truth. The Most High says that he's going to do all this. I'll prove it. Let us go to the book of Joel. Let's go to Joel. Book of Joel. Now watch this right here, my sister and brother. Joel chapter 3. Look what it says here in verses 1 and 2, okay? I'm going to read verse 3:2 because it's some disturbing stuff in verse 3:2. But let us read. It says, For behold, in those days and in that time when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations, see what I'm saying? And will bring them down to the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them. Therefore, who? My people. Not the whole world. See, Jesus is talking about dividing the sheep and the goats and all over there. God said he's only concerned about his people. Now, the Christians, they're in trouble. And look what he says here. He says, plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel. I mean, he comes out and tells you who he's going to be pleading for. Now, my sisters and brothers, Israel. Do you recall, I know you read when the Most High sent Moses down into Egypt and he put 10 plagues on Egypt, didn't he? In the 10th one, he told Moses, he said, go on down there and I'm going to put this 10th one on him and then I guarantee you he gonna let you go. See, God pleaded with Pharaoh on numerous occasions. Let my people go that they may come and worship me, that they may serve me. See that? Here, we cannot really fully serve God like we supposed to because we don't know all the rules and all the festivals and all the feasts and all these other things that we should be doing. You know, we can't do them because we don't have a leader. But he says that he's going to raise up King David, all right? He's going to raise up all the Levites, all the priests. He's going to put all those things, he's going to put the judges back in there. He's going to put kings, you know, little small kings, you know, in positions and stuff like that. And David's going to be over all of us, King David. But we can't do everything that he asked of us to do in the days of old because we don't know everything. But look what he says here. Look what he says. He says, my people Israel, my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Now, they have parted the land over there. You know, the fake ones, they over here, and then they got the Palestinians over here. And they throwing rocks, shooting rockets, you know, fighting over a land that doesn't even belong to them. And right here in the scripture, it tells you that they parted, they have divided it up. Saying that this is ours, and we gonna stay over here on the West Bank, and we don't like y'all, and y'all don't like us, and they was put over there in our land. They're fighting over property that does not even belong to them. Anyway, let's go a little further here. And this is why, this next verse is why the Most High does not want us integrating with other races. I don't know why, you know, people think, well, you know what, well, it's okay. No, it's not okay. God is the one that separated us. He said, you are a holy people. He said, I have separated you from everybody else. So, but here in America, they call this the melting pot, so all nations can come in and go together. See, that's why the Most High says that, over in Amos, he says, he's going to sift Israel from among all nations. And if anyone knows anything about working in a kitchen, and cooking in a kitchen, and using the sifter, you use the sifter in order to separate that which is real from that looks like it real. And this is what God is saying. God is saying that I'm going to sift my people, my heritage from all nations. I mean, why would you, if everybody is going, why would you use a sifter to separate? I mean, my sisters and brothers, it is already clear cut. It's already cut and dry. I mean, all we gotta do is just look in the pages. But look what he says here. He says, and they have cast lots for my people, and have given a boy for a harlot. See that? Now here in America, they want people to put on dresses and stuff. I mean, when you start hanging outside your race, they will lead you away from the Most High. He said that all through the Old Testament. He said, when you go out there and mess with those strange people, he said, they're going to carry you away from me. And this is what they do. But we can't see it. We want to be like them. No, be like yourself. You are unique. You are different. We are nothing alike. Here it is, summertime. The sun shining down, is rays and whatnot. I'm not out here putting no sunscreen on. I don't need any. Why? Because he already given me mine. I got mine. But they'll lie to you and tell you on television, oh, you need sunscreen on. No, you don't. You already got it in your skin. Now, let's go a little further here. He said, give a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. And see, years and years ago, I remember this right here, in the black community, if there was a word that came up that a individual in the community was a homosexual or a punk, you know, that they call them a sissy or a faggot, oh man, that was a disgrace. But now, oh, they wear it as a badge of honor now. Because of what someone else is doing, and they tell you that it's okay. It's not okay, my sisters and brothers. God intended for you to be with your own people and for you to make others that look like you. When you go outside your race, I know many men are like this, but I don't care. When you go outside your race and you make a baby, you just committed suicide. Because that is not you. That is not you because you outside your race. But when you mate with one that is your race, then you get the same thing that you are. You get yourself. But when you make something else, that's not you. You can claim it all you want to, but it's not. But anyway, here is what I'm saying here. God pleaded with Egypt. And he put 10 plagues on them. God is going to plead with all nations to release his people that they may come and serve him. Now, I'm going to read one more scripture here. Let's go to Isaiah 66. Let us go there. Isaiah 66. Real quick. Now, watch this right here. Isaiah 66, verse 15. Look as they said, for behold, verse 15. The Lord will come with fire and with his chariot. Talking about his flying saucer now. His chariot of fire. Like a whirlwind to render his anger and fury and rebuke with flames of fire. For by fire and by his sword will the Lord plead with all flesh. And the slain of the Lord shall be many. See that? God is only concerned about his own people. My sisters and brothers. You have to see it for it's right here on the pages. I'm not taking anything and rearranging words. No, it's right here on the pages. You have to see it for whatever it is. God has a people. God, the Most High, had Abraham sleep with his sister, Sarai. That was his true sister. She wasn't just another woman out there. That was his sister. And if you go back and you look at the ancient times, the pharaohs and the Anunnakis and all those Ramses and all of them back in those days, they slept with their own sister and their grandmother. Why? To keep the bloodline pure. Now, why would they go through all that trouble to keep their bloodline pure if it wasn't significant? My sisters and brothers, if you do your research on it, just go back and look at the history of Egypt, and not only those other cultures also, they all did the same thing because it was important to keep the bloodline pure. My sisters and brothers, we here at LightOfMeNoMore.org, we wish all of our sisters and brothers all over a happy Sabbath. Until next time, shalom.